Hello, I want to talk to you a bit about the geography of my garden, and particularly the geography that I think about when I grow the food that I do. And here is my small vegetable patch, and you can see some of the things that I grow to try to give some degree of self-sufficiency, although not entirely, of course, to my family of four people. So there's various things here that we will be able to eat throughout the summer, hopefully, and beyond. Now, the garden is a big store of carbon, and the way in which we choose to garden means that we can keep and maintain quite a lot of carbon in the soil that should be there, or help to bind more up into the soil, as opposed to it being added to the atmospheric store, which is going to be part of climate change. So climate mitigation can be done individually by the way you do it, by the choices you make in terms of your garden and the soil in it. So we can start to think about things like flood mitigation and preventing the loss of species, increasing biodiversity. Now, we all have a food carbon footprint with all the food that we eat. Some food that we eat and some of the choices we make have a more significant carbon footprint. Some of the vegetables, which perhaps are the most perishable ones, that are often flown into this country, perhaps have the biggest of carbon footprints. We're talking here perhaps tomatoes. We've got a tomato plant that's growing there quite well. The one here.
A couple of tomatoes on there, they're nearly ready.
That's my first ones of the year. Aubergines are another one that are quite perishable. I've got three aubergine plants up there and one just down here. And peppers as well. So over here is the peppers and chilies section of my greenhouse on this bench. I also subscribe to, or just to some extent anyway, the idea of no dig, because the more we dig the soil, the more we allow air into it and the more carbon is released from it, and again that carbon shouldn't be released from it ideally. So what we can do is, rather than digging it and putting the nutrients into it with via compost, we can put it on the top and allow the worms and the microbes and everything else to do its thing, and draw those nutrients from that compost down into the soil. And indeed, the compost that we use shouldn't have too much peat in it, shouldn't have peat in it at all, because peat from peat bogs is a long-term store of carbon, which we don't want to be releasing from those peat bogs, never mind any issues of biodiversity of that, what can be lovely and pristine wetland environments. This is my plastic compost bin, and I put into there a mixture of green leaves and grass clippings and things, and some what we call browns, so dead organic matter. And if you mix those together with the peelings, I haven't got too much of a scientific method, but it seems to do the job. We want to have a blend of carbon and nitrogen with a bit of air to turn it over with a fork, and also it needs enough water in it as well. Okay, so I suppose the final point I would make would be about buying plants. So I try and minimize the number of plants that I buy as small plants. It's not always possible, but if you're buying small plants that you're going to hopefully grow in the garden, or you're going to have as vegetables eventually, then those are going to have a bigger carbon footprint, because those plug plants that you buy, those small plants you buy, are going to probably be grown in peat. They're probably going to have been grown at some point in their life under artificial lights with artificial heat, which is again going to add to that carbon footprint, never mind the fuel costs and the transport costs involved. Okay, well, I hope you got something from that. Thank you very much.